Hi, welcome to Daily Current Affairs presented by Narayana IAS Academy. Firstly, currency swap agreement. A currency swap agreement is a mechanism to exchange currency between two countries. The currency can be their own or belonging to a third country. The World Bank first introduced currency swaps in 1981. Under this agreement, India and Japan can exchange currency worth $75 billion. The exchange has to be reversed after an agreed period. This agreement is up to 50% higher than the last swap agreement between the two countries. How does this agreement help India? Firstly, the swap agreement should aid in bringing greater stability to foreign exchange. It will act as a second line of defense after the $393.5 billion foreign exchange reserve. Secondly, there is no immediate cost. Only when an amount is drawn, you have to repay it. Thirdly, it improves the market sentiment. That is, speculators who buy and sell dollars based on geopolitics and geoeconomics will be pacified and hence they will be more stable. And fourthly and most importantly, foreign investors in India bringing FDI and FII and also external commercial borrowers will draw comfort from the agreement because the exchange rate will be stable. India-Japan bilateral relations. This is a very important topic for prelims as well as GS2. Let us first explore India-Pacific as there is potential for a lot of GS questions. As we already know, Japan is a stratovolcanic archipelago which is on a lot of tectonic plates. It is on the East Asian Pacific coast. Japan is also the fourth largest island country. The latitudes of Japan starts from 20 degrees north to up to 45 degrees north. In comparison, the southernmost point of Japan is somewhere near the Ahmedabad latitude in India, and Tokyo, which is located at 35 degrees north, is located on the same latitude as Srinagar. Let us compare the latitudes of Beijing, Tokyo and Delhi. Beijing is located on 39 degrees north, Tokyo on 35 degrees north and Delhi on 28 degrees north. Therefore, if you come from north to south, it is Beijing first, Tokyo second and Delhi third. The seas around Japan are towards the north. This is the Sea of Ohotsk. Towards its east, this is the Sea of Japan. Towards its southeast, this is the East China Sea. And towards this south, this is Philippine Sea. Now let us study Indo-Pacific. This sea that we are observing here is the South China Sea, which is under the lot of controversy, which we will be discussing in the coming slide. Secondly, this shipment route starting from Suez Canal, starting from Gulf, coming through Indian Ocean, passing from the Cape of Comorin towards the Andaman Nicobar Islands, through Malacca Strait into the South China Sea and through the Philippine Sea into the Pacific Ocean, is one of the most busiest transportation shipping corridor in the world. This is under threat from the dominance of China. The four most important agreements between India and China this year are: firstly, the commitment towards free and open Indo-Pacific. This concept actually arises because it is a response to China's growing dominance in the region. As we already know, China is building the Silk Road Initiative, under which it has built ports along the Indian Ocean. Sitwe, Hambantota, Maldives, Djibouti are some of the strategic ports which can also act as military bases if needed. Secondly, the highly disputed South China Sea is an important part of the transportation corridor. Hence, occupancy of it by China will reduce the freedom of transportation, the freedom of shipment. Therefore, India and Japan wants to implement the rule of law. The rule of law here discussed is the UNCLOS, which gives how a sea is governed. Under this law, the International Court of Justice has ordered China that the South China Sea does not legally belong to it. However, China is actively infringing on it by building artificial islands. And thirdly, the new security architecture, which is known as Quad, between India, Australia, Japan, and USA. The vision statement specifically mentioned the relationship between and the willingness to expand the cooperation with the US and other countries. And secondly, and most important agreement is acquisition and cross-service agreement. It is a logistic sharing pact that would allow Japanese ships to get fuel and servicing from Indian ports and vice versa. This is important because it allows Japanese ships to come and stay and service in the strategically important Andaman Nicobar Island ports, which will help if China blocks Malacca Strait. Next is the 2+2 dialogue. The 2+2 dialogue is between the defense and the foreign minister of the two countries, which is scheduled to happen every year. This will improve the bilateral understanding between the two countries. And finally, on the economic front, we have already discussed, India and Japan have signed the currency swap agreement. And along with it, Japanese Prime Minister has committed that 57 companies are willing to invest 320 billion yen in India. Next, green firecrackers. Green crackers are developed by CSIR and NIRI using ecologically safe raw materials. What is the technology involved? In any crackers, is comprised of alkali nitrates and aluminium powder. Alkali nitrates are the nitrates of barium, arsenic, lead, strontium, and etc., which produce colors, and aluminium, which is used as a primary heat source to produce the flash. The researchers have decided to replace aluminium with magnesium and alkali metals like barium, arsenic, lead, etc. On the understanding that these changes would reduce the ignition temperature and subsequently minimize the particulate matter coming from the cracker. What are the terminology? This might be important for prelims, so please follow me. The researchers from NIRI have developed the greener version of what are called as Bijli crackers. The three prototypes are known as SWAS, which is Safe Water Releaser, SAFAL, Safe Minimum Aluminium, and STAR, Safe Thermite Cracker. What are the advantages? The particulate matter was reduced by 30-35% in SWAS and 35-40% in SAFAL and STAR. And the manufacturing cost is also reduced by 30%. This will immensely help the air pollution in many cities of India. Why is this in use? The Supreme Court has said that only green crackers should be permitted across the country. But Ministry of Environment has said that there is little likelihood of mass availability of green crackers this year. However, they would do everything to mass production of green crackers next year. Operation Green. Operation Green has been launched because of the plight of tomato, onion and potato farmers. These farmers face a lot of problems because of erratic prices. The price of onion, which one at one time ranges 100 rupees per kilo, falls to 20, and often we see the tomatoes are sold at as low as 3 rupees per kilo, which is not at all remunerative. These problems arise for the farmer due to three reasons. Firstly, mass production. Farmers don't plan the crop. They go by their ancient knowledge, which is causing the problems. Secondly, there is lack of storage facility. And thirdly, there is lack of transportation. The Operation Green aims to aid farmers and help control the limit the erratic fluctuations. How does the government aim to do it? Firstly, the government aims to create farmer production organizations. Secondly, it aims to develop agri-logistics. That is, it aims to set up more cold storages and transportation facilities. And thirdly, Government aims to set up processing facilities so that the produce can be immediately turned into other products so that it need not be stored, and processing also helps to increase the revenue that the farmers get. Why is this in news? 9 months after announcing the Operation Green to provide the rightful price to farmer producers, the Union government has prepared the guidelines to implement the operation. Under this, the government has subdivided it into short-term component and long-term component. Under the short-term component, the government has allocated 50 crores. Out of this, this will be used for 50% share of the cost with NAFED, National Agriculture Cooperative Marketing Federation of India, for transportation and storage facilities of TOP producers. Under the long-term budget, for which 450 crores is allocated, is meant to develop value chains, cold storage, packaging, sorting, grading and processing industries. Lastly, India's largest dry dock. India's largest dry dock is inaugurated at Cochin Shipyard in Kerala. What is the importance? The dry dock will give impetus to Make in India, under which ships can be built and repaired. This initiative comes under Sagarmala. Hence, if this is successful, India's share in global shipbuilding will rise to 2% from the currently meager 66% share, which is minimal or negligible in comparison to India's potential. Secondly, the commercial shipbuilding industry in India is only worth 3,200 crores and focuses only on small and medium-sized offshore vessels and bulk carriers. Hence, there is a huge potential for shipbuilding and repair in India. Thank you. See you tomorrow.